Welcome back to Rush Hour. My name is Mubarak Mugabo. We're still in the big issue and we are looking at the law on narcotics and the effect that it causes on Ugandans and certainly what needs to be done to ensure that we deal with these actual challenges. With me in the studio is Grace Bikumbi. He's a clinical psychologist. Grace, before you left for a break, I was actually still asking you about this whole narcotics and certainly the effect that it puts on people. It looks like in this country, it is not easy by the way to point to a female. It looks like it has been categorized to be an effect that is usually gone, you know, that is usually put on men, on boys. If, for example, a girl does something that is out of, out of normal, they will say, maybe it's something else. But if it's a man, it's marijuana. How did we get to even make this a gender issue?
Mubarak, that's a very, very nice outlook. Why? Because the good thing, I'm also a specialist in clinical care for women with substance use disorders. It's also specialties of itself. But the reason is, there's a big animal called stigma. A big animal, that big monster called stigma. Girls, women, fear to access care. Girls, women, even parents and relatives of women or girls fear to access care. If you have your daughter, someone fear to say that, okay, his daughter has a mental problem. His daughter is using drugs, or her daughter is using drugs. He rather
keeps quiet, yes.
And imperative said that, okay, my son is doing drugs. At least he feels a little bit better.
A little better, he's a son. Because I mean
he's a boy.
He's absolutely,
boy.
Yes.
He's a boy. But my girl is using drugs. But the thing is, many girls are using substances. Many families are actually dying silently.
And they are engaging in protecting them because they think they are protecting the image of their families.
And the big animal or the big fish there is stigma. That's the big monster.
Stigma on whose part?
The part of the caregivers, that's the family. Because, I mean, in their family, they have a girl who uses drugs. So they want to protect, they are protective. But also stigma on the patient or the girl or the lady or the woman herself, because she fear to access care in case of substance use disorder. But move around town or any town there, in Mbarara, Kampala,
hostels.
Kalmoja, hostels.
Hostels.
The dads, families, mummies are home. They think their
daughter
girl
is in class.
Yeah, daughter is in class. My daughter is very good. And when she comes back home, she's very good. She's just, everything is on top notch. But go to hostels, then Kampala roaming day and night. Yesterday I got a chance to drive briefly. Don't say, Grace, why are you going at night? I was also, you know, it's good to socialize a bit. So I was driving through Kampala, streets of Kampala, and I found girls because it is Valentine's Day. These are university hostel girls.
University students.
University students. They are in clubs smoking shisha. There is this thing called shisha. Viper, about Viper, something. They have a lot of street names. I'm going for Viper. It's a vibe.
There is a vibe.
There's a vibe.
And Grace, when you don't have a vibe.
I have a vibe.
They will say Grace doesn't have a vibe.
Doesn't have a vibe. Let's go and vibe. And when they say, let's go and vibe, these girls are smoking. They have thrown house parties for drugs, cakes for drugs, cookies with full of drugs. These girls are being drugged, but also boys. And
so
what?
So the recruitment into this drug addiction does not know gender.
It does not know gender. Today I read, I think somewhere, I don't know if it was on social media, where a hostel girl was raped.
Yes, that happens, honestly.
So, that happens. If you find out what time, where, and how, it also ring. It will be a question mark.
We have actually been hearing that, even in hostels where people are having you know, intimate affairs in a group, you find like three different, we have had that in Dubai spaces, yeah, bed spaces, and yeah, of course the Arab world,
yeah,
but also in hostels.
In hostel, but mostly
could that be also part of?
Mubarak, I want to let you know that we need to wake up to save Uganda. For the listener out there, for you are happy that your child is very okay, but you need also to check on your children in hostels.
Where they are, where
who they
interact with.
Where they, who are they interacting with? Are they even going to class anyway?
But the problem is that, Grace, you are local. People will say you are local. I mean, you need to, yes.
Because, like, for example, you're not Merino.
Yes.
I mean,
they will call you local because, for example, Shisha. Is Shisha really a Ugandan or an African thing?
Now, these things are being borrowed from the European countries. That's why, at one point, I appreciate the president. I mean, he's a person, he's someone who is understanding some of these things by banning the recent lesbians and gay,
yes,
you know? Then it is European world things, the Sisha. We didn't used to have a Sisha back then. But Sisha, these are things that are put in pipes, and yes, then you find someone smoking and enjoying. You find many girls, boys smoking, they are in circle, vapor is coming out of the mouth, out of the nose. I've even told them some maybe it's coming out from down. Kagamba is just pushing out, but this Shisha is mixed with marijuana, is mixed with heroin.
I thought Shisha is just
No, these are drugs. They mix with the drugs, but they put in very addictive content, but also flavor. They deceive them by saying it's vanilla.
Vanilla.
And yes, vanilla. Lemon. And chocolate. And lemon. So it's a trend. Can I do lemon? Can I do vanilla? Just to pull you. Because someone is earning money.
Out of it.
Out of it.
But the effect
is imperative. The effect is grave.
Is marijuana, for example, is Shisha, for example, more dangerous than marijuana? Or it's, You can't quantify the effect.
I wouldn't quantify the effect now, but the fact these are all drugs, because even the Shisha itself is a drug. I mean, they mixed. The other one is vapor, but they have mixed drugs that they are putting fire there. So fire is burning the drug to produce vapor. So you don't know which drug. They're mixing marijuana there. They're mixing heroin there. They're mixing cocaine there. And for you are becoming addicted. That's why you say, I like Shisha of the other place.
Yes.
Hey, I want to smoke from the other place. Because there's that addictive content that has been mixed in these drugs.
Do we need to control media? I mean, what kind of content do Ugandans, are Ugandans supposed to watch? Because when you look at these issues, you are actually it's your evidence that these are actually cultures read or studied from movies, from actually sub content from outside, and people tend to normalize this. Is there a need to also regulate content, as we are also talking about whether this law that was recently assented onto by the president is able to bridge the gaps?
Yeah, I think there is a need to do so, because I would imagine a young child watching pornography. I would imagine a younger child watching people playing sex on a television. I would imagine a younger child or this growing teen seeing Snoop Dogg smoking, enjoying, and he has, you know, those songs of, is it hip hop?
Yes.
Yap yo, yap ye, yap. And then he has a very big
cigar.
So what will happen? This is modeling. This kid want to be like Snoop Dogg.
Yes.
He want to imitate what Snoop Dogg is doing. So he also want to get that big cigar. He would want to feel the same. He would want to have the same vibe. So he'll actually end up learning. So I think, to me, it is important to regulate media. Media has caused a lot of
good and harm.
Harm.
Good and harm.
On children. But also good, because it is, I mean, there are different types. I'm a lecturer also.
Mm.
I do lecturing. So I always tell my students, instead of going to research on Google, most of them are in TikTok. And when you open TikTok, a lot of funny things, people are naked, people are, you know. So what will, it will corrupt your brain. Instead of searching for news,
this is normal.
Instead of searching for good news, instead of seeing what is happening in the world, the political affairs.
Are you not, Grace, are you not expecting too much from Ugandans and Africans? Because it looks like we don't seem to appreciate mental health and mental illness at a broader level. Which area do you think should we start from to ensure that this is, because once people are conscious about it, then you can easily talking about the remedies and certainly controls. But we are looking at controls before you even think about whether Ugandans or even people, local people, appreciate the fact that these things do exist and they need some controls.
I think my first take would be on awareness. Before even I go to prevention, because we say that prevention
is better than cure.
So my first point would be on prevention. That's why, Grace, I'm supposed to be in a hospital now, but I am taking time to come because I'm given this chance.
You're
and
coming
time.
To address the source,
telling even that young one who'd be listening to this television that drugs are bad. Instead of waiting for them to come to hospital for treatment. Do you get that? So prevention is a key. If we put in awareness, we prevent, because we have to look at PHC, that is a primary health care. If we incorporate mental health in primary health care, then we are going to bridge the gap. But if we are there and just waiting for people who are mentally ill and we treat, then we are not heading anywhere. So what is my cry here? I really say that the government should put in much money in mental health. Butabika Hospital, other rehabilitation centers. I mean, there's even private.
There's also some kind of
stigma
around Butabika.
They should be given money, bills, yes.
I don't know whether you have faced this in the public. Once people actually talk about Butabika, what comes to their mind is that this person might be mad.
That is very true. And the reality, the time I started working in Butabika, just me being in a bus, which is written on Butabika, when I passed via Kampala and I peeped my head out, I saw someone saying, those are people with mental illness. I am a worker, but because the bus has Butabika Hospital, they actually think even possibly the workers have meant.
Possibly the driver.
The driver.
If you are driving,
yes.
And then the Butabika Hospital bus is behind you, you may think this driver is having issues.
Because of people don't know, people are not aware. This is a name. Just like Muyenga.
Just like Mulago.
Just like Mulago.
Just like Chirudu. Just like Muyenga or Kololo.
Jinja. So that's Butabika.
But the conception of people, the way they conceive
and that perception, like thinking people is mental. Butabika will find people throwing stones,
yes.
People angry, aggressive. No, that's not it.
By the time actually somebody says this person needs help is when they strip naked
or start throwing stones. That's not the case. It could be worker-related stress that is going to drive your worker you employ into distress and then to depression. It could be family-related affairs. So the stigma related to this hospital called Butabika is still there. And if someone possibly is told to go to Butabika, it's like he's on a deathbed. Yeah, death sentence. Not knowing they're telling you go to either Mulago and
you
do
will still
check
find
up.
Exactly.
And then people have perception. When I was still young, thinking when you go to Butabika, you'll find machines that will swing you.
Yes.
You know, will. And then when people come, like, where are the machines? I don't see the machines to test me.
You have reminded me. You know, I'm also one of the people who never appreciated mental health and even mental illness until I interacted face to face with these people. There is a person that actually I studied with who was going through these kind of challenges. Although it wasn't actually after narcotics, but I think also at some point he used them to ensure that maybe he can resolve his issues.
Yeah.
This is not something that any person who has not interacted with this area can actually appreciate.
Yeah, that's true.
There is a, I had gone to do a story in Butavika at one point.
Mm.
And I had a camera person.
Mm.
You know, when we reached the gate, the camera person stopped. He said, he's a journalist, by the way.
Mm.
He said, where are we going? I was like, we are going to the hospital. He's like, but are we safe?
Yes.
You understand?
Mm.
So the perception around even Butavika, is it even not a time for people, for the government to rebrand?
I don't think
this,
it would.
This whole issue, yeah. I mean, this whole hospital.
Mm.
It, when you change the name,
mm.
it Might will not will change the in. Substance. Because it is just form.
No, I don't think that would be a good idea for the policymakers and panels. But to me, I think the big fish here is awareness.
Mm.
Because like changing where people are going to access HIV, and you want to hide in there.
The content of yeah. Butavika Hospital, yeah. the yeah. services,
yeah.
but the branding itself.
But why should we have to remain with this? Because we have to let people that mental illness is real. So, only that the word itself in Uganda
is possibly. Exactly. That's the point.
It's like Butavika Matabufu.
Yes.
And for us, actually, if you went in the Butavika Hospital where there are many specialists, as I said, there are psychiatrists, like clinical psychologists, there are social workers, mentioned nurses. But the thing is, we don't have a person who has, who we can call mad.
Yes.
That is not in the vocabulary of mental illness. Actually, if you come to me and you say, my father is mad, my relative is mad, I would first psych-educate you. We don't have mad people.
Mm.
We have people suffering from mental illness.
Is it that parents are living in denial, not to accept that their children are actually on drugs, or even, by the way, workspaces?
Yeah.
Not many workspaces appreciate these concepts.
Mm.
Is it the fact that we are living in denial, or they have nowhere to run to for help?
It is very true. Most, as I say, I also work with Kampala Youth Recovery Foundation. This one is a private rehabilitation center, and also with the Presidential Initiative, which is a rehabilitation for the ghetto youth. But the most thing we find here is stigma from the parents, because parents don't want to appreciate that their children are actually having drug-related issues. They actually, if you even do assessment and you say, no, I think I've seen red flags of substance use, they'll first argue with you. But my boy is okay. My boy is fine. He has no problem. Then when you go ahead by saying, okay, can we do a drug screening?
Uh-huh.
On doing drug screening, you find the boy has been using substances. But some parents also just know this when they start seeing their children changing slowly from the previous behaviors they used to exhibit to the current behaviors.
Mm.
Because someone used to be very good, someone used to have a very good listening here, someone would come and greet daddy, how are you in the morning? Mommy, how are you? Mommy, are you okay?
These days he says hi.
Hi. Hi, daddy. How are you?
Hi, daddy.
What's up? Sweet. Then in the dining, you can't see him. You used to eat together, maybe even parenting.
Family, yes.
Yeah, mm. You need to sit together. You sit together as a family, have a meal together. But you no longer see this boy. He's always in his bedroom, hiding away. He's always in his bedroom, coming. When he comes, picks food. So parents sometimes don't appreciate that their children. Actually, I wouldn't say they don't appreciate. In most cases, these children hide.
Mm. Some of these
I have seen some children who have used drugs for the last 15 years at home, but their parents have known on the 17th year that my boy is using drugs. So when you do assessment, this boy tell you, I started in senior two, but he has graduated and is working. I started alcohol at home, but when I in the hostel, but when I come home, I used to pretend I'm a good boy.
But now the business element of banning, you know, drugs, I mean marijuana, growing of marijuana, there's a lot of money in it. We are looking at cat producers, actually want the president to reverse the ban. Looks like for you also, psychologists like you, Grace, you're looking at the mental health, mental illness, aspect. Without necessarily looking at the business component aspect of it. Are you not being economical and conscious?
You see, when these bills are passed, I'm not a politician, but I actually tend to have studied a bit of public health and then policy. I actually have a master's in policy. So that's why these policy issues, I try to understand them. You see, that's why the speaker called different areas and disciplines, trade, health, and others, to sit together and agree on what are the consequences on the economy. I know the government, of course, gets bags some good money, but I mean, the money which is bagged is again taken to the Cancer Institute. You get that?
It becomes a cycle.
It becomes a cycle. So, I mean, you're getting money from something.
Instead of taking it to build a road, you're taking
it to treat. But you're taking it to treat.
The people that have been actually affected by your source of money.
Thank you. So, what's that?
It becomes...
It's a point of discussion for someone out there. It's a point of thinking through.
Let's wind up this conversation, Grace. Yeah. What are your key recommendations?
I want to appreciate and also encourage everyone out there that let's wake up, because we are sitting on a time bomb. Let's wake up, let's rise up, let's create awareness. For those who can actually put in anything, please, together we can, and we can make Uganda a better country, but also let's appreciate mental health, let's appreciate working with people with mental illness, and let's avoid the stigma.
Absolutely.
Mental health
is wealth. So if, for example, one wants to have access to you, how do they get to you, and how does even somebody start a process of seeking for help?
It is very okay. I'll leave my contacts here. But also, I said you can access the National Referral Mental Hospital. Treatment is free that side, but also of the private rehabilitation center where you can. Because the most important thing here is help.
Yes.
You're not looking at private, public, but how help. Are we getting help? So we have a private center that we can also help you, treat you, assess you, and then possibly, because we work as a team. So when you come, you'll get the help that you need from the professionals. And then, of course, you'll live in a better Uganda when you're a healthy person.
Where do they find you?
You'll find me in Butabika Hospital, if you come to the public side. But in a private setting, you'll find me in Kampala Youth Recovery Foundation, which is an NGO for rehabilitation of people with substance use disorders. And also my number, you can call me and I schedule appointment. So I'll find out if you need a consultant.
Read your number, because we actually
0774. For those who can find me on 0774
30 68 96.
0774 30 68 96. And I remain Grace Bikumbi, a clinical psychologist and addiction professional.
Thank you so much, Grace. Yeah. This is a very interesting conversation that we are having, and I think we need to expound it at some times. We need to tackle issues beyond just even drugs. We need to, mental health is so wide.
Depression.
And I think certainly we will have some more time to discuss mental health, mental illness, and certainly what needs to be done to ensure that things actually get better. Thank you so much for watching and keeping it urban. We've been discussing the law on narcotics and certainly the effect that it puts on the Ugandan population. And of course, we've been having a senior clinical psychologist talking about this and of course, how to get help once you need help. We want to take a short break. When we return, Maizra Amit is having a very interesting guest. He's a comedian, and certainly it is coming after this very short break. This is The Rush Hour. A very good morning.